Hey TCS TV viewers, it's Dave and Evelyn from the Camera Store, and today we're going to give you a hands-on look at the Sony 35mm f1.4 G Master lens.
Thirty-five millimeter happens to be my favorite focal length. If I was given one option to choose to go on a deserted island, it'd be a 35 1.4 lens.
Now, why, Dave?
Now, part of that was years ago, I was a zoom guy, right? Everything I shot, I have to have all my bases covered, all my focal lengths. But we brought in Vince Musey, a very popular National Geographic photographer, for a seminar, and at the end of it was a question and answer period, and someone asked, your favorite lens and a camber combination? He said, 35mm 1.4 and a full frame body.
Yeah, and I totally agree with that. It's an excellent lens for shooting environmental portraits. You get more of your background in than other tighter prime lenses, and it's also wide enough that you can shoot landscapes, you can shoot street portraits, pretty much anything with it.
35mm is a very popular focal length, and there's lots to choose from on the market. We decided to put the G Master lens up against the very popular Sigma 35mm 1.2 lens. Now, it is bigger, but bigger isn't necessarily always better, or is it? That's what we want to get to the bottom of between these two lenses. Now, I really like the image quality I'm getting out of the 35mm Art Series 1.2 lens, but there are things that I don't like about it, and one of them is the physical size and weight of this. Now, this lens comes in at about 2.4 pounds, just over 1,000 grams. The G Master lens is half that weight. It's pretty impressive they're able to do that. And physically, the size of it, you're about an inch and a half difference in the length of these two lenses. Something else I like about the G Master lens over the Sigma is the filter size. We have a 67mm filter thread on the G Master lens, where we have an 82mm filter here. Filters are going to be much more expensive when you step up into that size.
This isn't the first time that Sony has come up with a 35mm prime lens for full frame. It's not even the first 35mm f1.4 lens, but it is their first G Master version. And in order to get that badge and that designation, it has to fit a lot of different criteria. So one of the things, obviously, is build quality. This is built to be compact, mobile, kind of a travel-ready lens, but it still feels like a high-quality lens and has a nice weight to it. I like that this lens has a focus hold button, which is fantastic. You can program it to a variety of different settings, and so it gives you some flexibility in your operation. I also like that we have a nice aperture ring. It goes from f1.4 up to f16, and it has the option to be de-clickable, and so that's fantastic for video. It also has a nice smooth focusing ring as well, and I find that it's actually smoother than the Sigma f1.2 35mm lens. I like that it came with this great hood. It's a cylindrical design, it's easy to put on, and I like that it has this rubberized end to it. And so it's easy, you can throw it in your bag or you can leave it standing up on its side, where the Sigma lens comes with a pedal hood, and so it's not quite as sturdy and it doesn't have that rubberized end that makes you feel secure in placing it in that position. This lens is also weather sealed for dust and moisture and has some great coatings on it that's going to prevent things like lens flare, ghosting, chromatic aberration. Sony has thrown everything at this lens to make sure that it has optimal optical quality.
When it comes to comparing lenses, one of the first things we're going to look for is how sharp these lenses are. And both of them are very, very sharp. But push comes to shove, I'd say the Sony is just marginally a little bit sharper than the Sigma. But you really got to be pushing those fine, fine details at 100% to see any difference whatsoever. Where the Sony does pull ahead of the Sigma is in its barrel distortion. It is a better corrected lens when it comes to vignetting and distortion. Now, the Sigma does have a 1.2 aperture, and you're thinking, great, I'm going to have even smoother, creamy bokeh. Now, with that, you do have a slight edge on the Sony at 1.2, but as soon as you start stopping it down, you're going to see a more geometric pattern to the bokeh balls. Take a look at these two shots here, one shot on the Sigma 1.2 at 1.2, and the other one at 1.4 with the G Master, and you'll see that the subtle differences in the bokeh balls. Step it down to 4.5 or 5.6 aperture, and you're going to start to see those geometric patterns appear with the Sigma.
Another area that Sony excels in is with autofocus performance. And this not only has to do with Sony's technology, how they've improved their overall focusing performance and their algorithms in the cameras, but also how well it pairs with their lenses. And it's no surprise to me that this G Master lens performs excellently with the latest Sony technology. It's fast, it's precise, and it's confident, and it works well for both stills and video. If you're considering this lens for video, I think it would be a good option. 35mm is wide enough that you could do some vlogging work, and since the minimum focusing distance is 27cm, you could shoot this at an arm's length. I also like that this has a D-click aperture ring, just like the Sigma one does, and it has a nice smooth focusing ring as well. We noticed that it did have significant focus breathing, which can be a problem if you're doing larger focus pulls. This is the one downside for video. Otherwise, it would actually pair nicely on a gimbal and make a nice video package if you're to pair this with one of Sony's full frame bodies. All right, Dave, when we started shooting this week, I know you wanted to take the bigger, the F1.2 Sigma lens, because that's just how you roll.
I do like the biggest, widest open aperture. I don't mind the size of lenses because why not? Let's go big. But in hindsight, I kind of regret my decision a little bit because I do really like what Sony has got going on with their G Master series of lenses.
Yeah, absolutely. This would be a fantastic travel lens, or just something that you could have almost in place of a zoom lens. I think it's a great focal length and works really well for photo and video. And we're not seeing enough of a difference between the two lenses in terms of optical quality and just the fall off with portraits. They both look fantastic, and I think you'd be happy with it with either option.
Yeah, I love 35mm 1.4. It's still wide enough to get a real feel of where you are, but enough depth of field that you can draw the viewer's attention to the subject you want.
Absolutely. Of course, we want to know, what do you guys think? Is this a lens that you're considering? Are you still stuck on the Sigma F1.2? Let us know in the comments below.
Make sure you follow us both on Instagram.
And if you're new to the channel, please subscribe, hit the notification bell, and we'll catch you again very soon. If you're still sticking around and you want to watch more, click up here to see our latest episode. And if you're local and you want to shop Canadian, click down here to shop the camera store. And of course, be sure to subscribe.